2021, the program has been expanded to include more cities, including Westerly. To qualify for the program, children must be 4 years old by September 1st and not be eligible for kindergarten. The Rhode Island House of Representatives will debate the proposed state budget for the upcoming fiscal year later this week. And one part of the measure drawing attention is a series of changes to state pension benefits. The nearly $14 billion tax and spending plan was unveiled Friday night. It includes money to rebuild the westbound Washington Bridge and boost funding for health care and education. I'm Sean Murphy. When news breaks, we break in.
The Densmore Oil and Bugbee Plumbing Seat of Honor.
Are you there?
He's up late to give you the news you can't get anywhere else early. He fights for truth and justice in the American way. Please welcome our pal from the Paragon Trust Company, the real Tony D. Tony D'Angelo.
Yeah, he's up late to bring you the news. He's up early today to bring you the news. You can follow Tony D at Tony D'Angelo 7 on the Twitter. Of course, his YouTube page is phenomenal as well. Make sure you subscribe to that. Tony, good morning, sir. How are you today?
Good morning, Lee Elci. Good morning, everybody, and proud to be among you.
So you want to begin with a public service announcement?
Well, yeah, you know, I've been getting into scrapes with people, and I don't mind. I mean, you have to tell people what you believe is the truth. And we're going to get into Dr. Anthony Fauci as we get into this, but I've been saying, you know, for a while that due to his conduct and misconduct, you know, he should be what the man did actually. If I did it or you did it or somebody else did it, it would be criminal. It would be racketeering. It would be concealment. It would be all the horrible things you could think of. And, you know, one bleeding heart came to me and said, you know, what's wrong with you, D'Angelo? We don't jail public servants, to which I responded, you know, public servants need to be in jail if they're involved in fraud and malfeasance and theft and dishonesty. So I'm not saying, Lee Elci, you know, we changed any hearts and minds in that discussion. But, you know, I looked at myself after this and I said, you know, why am I doing what I do? And I said, you know, if I have a purpose, I like to think I have several purposes. I like to think I'm something in this life besides a potted plant. But what I want to do here, you know, where our friend and colleague and pal George Colley says he's the government and media watchdog, my job here is to make the politician's life and the bureaucrat's life harder, and not necessarily, you know, without reason, not because I hate their guts or anything like that, at least not without provocation, but to make them accountable, because I go back a lot of years, for too many years, regardless of where I've been, especially in a place like Connecticut, they've had it really easy, and it's been very chummy, and it's been very, how could I put it, unless something went way off the rails. And, you know, King Governor Ned Lamont, the unaccountable, and COVID-19 is the, you know, that's the gold standard for all of this. So if I'm going to do one thing here, I'm going to tell you, I'm going to tell everybody what I see happening. I'm not a perfect person. But it's going to be across party lines. It's going to be, you know, straight to the heart, because I love people. I love the humble person. I am a humble person. I grew up under very humble circumstances, and that's what I want to do here. And I just wanted to, you know, make that clear, and thank you for this opportunity.
Well, you know, as you were saying that, I kept the same word kept coming into my brain. You're holding people accountable, and that's, and we all are very appreciative of that and the work that you do behind the scenes. People probably don't realize how many hours that you actually put in to dig through a lot of the stuff that you deliver to us, you know, every Tuesday with me and then every Thursday on your own and in other spots when you're posting stuff up on Twitter. So I think what you do is a tremendous service, not only to the people of the state of Connecticut, but beyond. So kudos.
Well, thanks. But I mean, that's, and again, I'm not perfect, but I want to do my best here. But anyway, yeah, Talking about holding your politicians and your bureaucrats accountable. Guess what happened yesterday? And you're not going to find this in any news or anything like that, but I was notified, because I'm on the list, because Kathy has a license, by the Connecticut Department of Health that they have been breached for the fourth time in 4 years. Now, you know, if you followed what we've done here, going back to the days of COVID-19, when we had the handover of the identities of the state people by Josh Cabal to the Boston Consulting Group, I was screaming, and I said, the one way, and I mean, you know, I'm a bank trust guy, any idiot, maybe not a politician, but any idiot knows that when you play fast and loose with data, bad things are going to happen. And since then, we've had like four breaches. And again, I started tearing off on several members of our esteemed legislature. I mean, namely, you know, Duff, Maroney, Wong, you know, who want to be these, you know, how could I put it, these paragons of technological virtues. And go deal with that, for crying out loud. You know, some poor nurse's aide is going to have her identity stolen. And, you know, you guys are championing AI and regulating AI and all this other stuff. And, I mean, and this goes back, and we discussed this on this show. I was looking at this last night, the Connecticut Data Privacy Act. You know, what a wonderful thing. Our data is not going to get to places and things like that, but the state is exempt. You know, it's like, hey, come on now. And, I mean, this passed the legislature unanimously. I mean, nobody's looking good here, frankly. This is just, I mean, this kind of crap is unfortunately crap, and that's just what it is. So, you know, it's just one, and I mean, there might be 10,000 things like this in a year, but man, you know, Lee Elci, we deserve better in this state.
We do. We always do. what we do, what is that? There's a line from a movie about deserve, I think. I can't remember what it is, but we deserve probably a lot better. What we get is what we get. But, you know, as far as the shady deals, deja vu, all of that all over again, give me some specifics on what you're talking about with that.
Well, actually, going to yesterday, which is really the story of the day, I spent 4 hours watching the House Select Committee on Investigating the Coronavirus, and of course the star witness was the esteemed Dr. Anthony Fauci. And what I watched, because I was like working and I had it up on the monitor on the other computer, was this incredibly skilled bureaucratic weasel. He's got long experience in doing his best to, you know, to dodge, to lie, you know, all the things that are predicted. And it's very clear that the House Select Subcommittee, where they were very quick to dump on Dr. David Morans, you know, I'm deleting my emails and that sort of thing, they want to make sure they continue to declare Fauci to sainthood. And I was very disappointed in some of the questioning by the Republican Congress people. Now, two people I think were fantastic. You know, Dr. Ronnie Jackson and Dr. Rich McCormick, I think, nailed them beautifully. But, I mean, it's like Nicole Malliotakis, I mean, you know, just slow-witted. I mean, I get the part about the dogs. I love animals, but you don't have to spend, you know, the precious time for minutes and minutes talking about the door. And Debbie Lesko's another one. But all of that being as it is, where I was personally disappointed, and I know I had this discussion with our friend Jan. She's like, you know, Tony, don't get terribly excited at congressional hearings. There's 150 pages of emails that committee released, okay, so they got it. I mean, I got it from them, and so did everybody else, where they didn't even really go down the questioning that was on those emails. You know, Dr. Fauci saying, well, you know, Peter Daszak of EcoHealth, I do not know this man. You know, Morans, oh, you know, he's just some guy, you know, that sort of thing. And I'm just looking at one email here, and this is April 21st, 2021. Peter Daszak sends it out. He sends it to Morans and a couple of other people, and he says that they're going to have a Zoom conference with Dr. Fauci. And he says, tell Tony, I'm pretty chummy for a guy you don't know, right, that this is the very early days, most of this criticism's coming from the right, and look for, you know, a national COVID commission, a conspiracy theory advocating for reduction in biosafety, viral work in wildlife and gain of function. And he makes the statement. Hopefully you can please feel free to share any docs I've sent to you with Tony. Hopefully you can do that in a way that avoids FOIA, and if not possible, just show them the stuff on the screen share on Zoom. Now, you know, unlike Morons, he doesn't know the guy, right? So June 28, 2021, this is Morons writing to Peter Daszak, that email being the email, getting from the beginning. Peter Daszak emailed me and Tony, congratulating Tony on standing up for science. That email somehow fell into the hands of a congressman, probably via a FOIA or someone who didn't delete it, as I did. Delete all of Peter's emails and others relating to Origin when the blank hit the fan. So the congressman got a copy of the email, and Tony and I or anyone else may have sent back to Peter. Mine was erased long ago. I verified that today. And the key lesson here is when you learn a subject is getting sensitive and you're starting to get harassed and hassled, you delete and that sort of thing. But basically, where I have been on this committee, and I had actually, I sent a tweet to Dr. Brad Weinstrup, and I said, you know, I think you guys here are missing the ball, because the key thing, you know, because you ask yourself, this whole horror of, you know, COVID and years and all the stuff, the masking, the distancing, the forced vaccines, all this kind of stuff. When they asked Fauci about, you know, well, what about the social distancing? Where'd that come from? He kind of looked like, I don't know. And everybody's like, well, what do you mean you don't know? But you know something, Lee Elci? The reason he didn't know, I'm not saying the guy is honest by any stretch of the imagination, but the reason he didn't know is all of this comes down to a master plan that was given to so many. And that master plan came from McKinsey. Now, we saw that going all the way back in 2019, where they were writing the COVID protocols for New Jersey. I've shown that slide. Now, the ties here run very, very deep. Fauci, right? He was with the development and policy with McKinsey. Look up McKinsey Gate in France and the work he did with Emmanuel Macron over there. And he was also the keynote speaker at a couple of conferences. FDA, NIH, Big Pharma, the states, the teachers' unions, all hired McKinsey. Andrew Cuomo, Phil Murphy, King Governor Ned Lamont the Accountable, all, you know, hired McKinsey, but, you know, our king buried it in a couple of nonprofits. And, you know, this was all the stuff that was there, mass, social distancing, racial equity. This is all part of a master design, the master plan. Because, look, you think Ned Lamont can come up with something like this on his own? Please, God help us all. You know, I'm going to start jumping off of buildings with a cape thinking I can fly. But I came across a report, and actually, not going to say how I got it, but where the, and there's tons and tons and tons and tons of written reports that actually they do a very good job of hiding, they being McKinsey. But this is a report called the Business Report on COVID-19 Implications for Business. And all of these things that, you know, we know of that we accuse politicians for, yes, the politicians should be, you know, accused for it. But they're all, every single point, every single thing we've looked at and scratched our head, it's all part of this thing which they call, and there's 36 points in this report, and every single heading is the Great Reset, the Great Reset, the Great Reset. And the other phrase they talk around, the next normal, the next normal. And the key things that are in it, vaccines, push the vaccines, make sure everybody gets vaccinated. Like Dr. Fauci was saying, you know, yesterday on the tape, you know, you you coerce them and the bleeps will lose shall we say, their whatever moral compass they have. The idea is to create fear and also media manipulation. Think of that in Connecticut, the $72 million, you know, COVID contract. So also, you know, racial justice and equity. The George Floyd incident, we could talk about that, but McKinsey sets up the Institute for Black Economic Mobility just like that. So this is a battle plan. This is something very big. And I mean, I was going through the report last night. I mean, it's 139 pages. More will come as it goes down to. Oh, here's another thing. I'm reading down on page 13 of the report. A big part of, quote unquote, the next normal is telemedicine. Who is the poster child for telemedicine? Guess who? Annie Lamont. So, you know, it's right in the report. I mean, it's like I'm not making this stuff up. But basically, it's when you look at this quote-unquote next normal reset and all this other sort of stuff, it's all a means of, like whatever you want to call it, whatever we might be going through in terms of struggles, in terms of business shutdowns and things. This is all part of the war we've got to get to the next normal. And, you know, believe me, there's a lot of material here, and I know we're just about going to run out of time, but it's basically financial control and stimulus and, you know, making sure that we have enough control over the banking system and things like that. And where this is incredibly significant, as far as I'm concerned, yeah, COVID-19 is, you know, let's call that a failed experiment on the next reset or whatever you want to call it. What's next? You know, what's coming down the road? Is it bird flu? Is it climate change? Oh, yeah. Climate change is a huge part of this report. Now, you know, the legitimacy of climate change, you decide that on your own. But I can tell you, people are writing the plans for this stuff. This wasn't concocted in the minds of politicians. Basically, the politicians are the useful idiots proliferating this stuff, you know, by and large. But when you have a state like Connecticut, when this stuff largely runs out of a nonprofit, Advanced CT, when the nonprofit has very prominent citizens on, or you know, quote unquote business leaders coming from Eversource and places like that and Quinnipiac University in this nonprofit. And, you know, this nonprofit, you know, due to an act of our legislature, is not subject to freedom of information. But yet the nonprofit can release the information. You see, you can't have it both ways. It's got to be one or the other. I mean, it's like they can do this again, 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 and again. And, I mean, I see a huge problem here. I really do. Because how can you, like, does a citizen, does a business owner, does a person, a parent have a right to know what the state policy is with respect to their lives? And I mean, you know, I'm not going to let off of this thing. I mean, basically, somebody else other than me has got to be screaming about the release of the records of Advanced CT going back to the reopen committee. What did they do? How did they do it? I've got to believe it's very similar to the rest of the McKinsey battle plan, but it's like, you know, I seeing Fauci yesterday, it's like, you know, there's a cloak here, there's a driver, and, you know, it's not what they all want us to believe. That's why they're paying media money to tell you something different.
And there's still people out there, Tony, who think Fauci walks on water. I can give you...
Oh, it's sickening. Absolutely sickening. But I think they're defending the status quo, Lee Elci.
I'm looking at the laundry list of things he got wrong. Social distancing, masking, travel restrictions, mandates, the lab leak theory, gain of function lies, conflict of interest. Just one after another, after another, after another. And again, they still have his picture up on their walls in some kitchens across
the
country.
But he needed an army to carry that out.
Yeah.
And he needed a lot more resources than he himself could muster. He might be the lightning rod for it. But, you know, it's the plans in that and the writing, because this report, I have links to other reports of pages and pages and pages about masking, about social distancing. I mean, he wasn't writing that stuff. McKinsey was.
Tony D'Angelo, you can find him on the Twitter or the X, Tony D'Angelo 7. And, of course, this Thursday you'll release yet another video.
This one's going to be a lot of fun. It's called It's My Party. We're going to see how party politics is really causing a lot of difficulties for folks, cutting right to energy, cutting right to food, and the very places we live. And this one is going to be a lot of fun to do.
All right, TD, thanks. I'll talk to you next time. Appreciate it. Tony D'Angelo, follow him. Get on the X and make sure you watch his videos. We'll be right back. Bruce Flax joins us here in the studio next. Hang on.
Meaning what they say now, never saying what they mean. While they while away the hours in their ivory towers, till they're covered up with flowers in the back of a black limousine. Whoa, la da 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 da. Talking about you and me.
Lee Elci.
As far back as I can remember, I always wanted to be a gangster.
Weekday mornings from 6 until 10 on 94.9 News Now. And stimulating talk. Traffic alert on 94.9.